More than an hour after the bright light, officers met up with the caller and his family.
What'd you see?
It was like a big creature.
A big creature?
Yeah, like around 10 feet tall.
I'm not going to BS you guys. One of my partners said they saw something fall out of the sky too, so that's why I'm kind of curious. Did you see anything land in your backyard? Or?
They see like a big, that's what they say. They see like a big something with light.
What I saw right now, I do believe in it. I got scared. Like, you guys don't, I mean.
Holy smokes. Police went into the backyard to investigate, but that part of the video has been blacked out because it's private property. Officers questioned neighbors, but haven't turned up any concrete answers. The American Meteor Society said several people across Eastern California.
The first recording is from the police body cam that caught the green flash in the sky in Las Vegas on April 30, 2023. The second recording is of the police response to a family's report of hearing a crash and seeing alien-looking creatures in their backyard on May 1st, 2023, also in Las Vegas. Just based off the first video, nothing indicates that the green flash is a UFO. The object behaved just like a meteor, and no one reported landing or crashing anywhere. The second video is what gave people other ideas. But for the sake of argument, let's assume that both events are connected, and were not fabricated or orchestrated by human sources. Here are the first questions that came to mind after I watched both videos. If aliens crashed in this family's backyard, why didn't anyone else in the vicinity report the unmistakable loud sound of a crashing aircraft? If 10-foot aliens did crash in the family's backyard, where did they hide in order to completely avoid human detection? And if they were going to use another aircraft to fly back up, why didn't anyone see it? I mean, after a crash that would have woken up the entire neighborhood, I can imagine a lot of people looking outside and trying to figure out what just happened. If aliens did crash in this family's backyard, how did they manage to leave no evidence of their presence whatsoever? Or why would they care so much to meticulously clear all types of evidence of their presence? And why is a race of technologically advanced, giant aliens still hiding on a planet so technologically underdeveloped as ours? None of it would make any sense. Then there's this video.
Check this out.
I'm trying to find the aliens in front of these guys, but I noticed something insane, and I want everybody, my two friends who will watch this, to take a look down, pay attention to two areas. We're going to look down here on the bottom right behind their fence and right up there. But we're going to first start down here because I found something crazy.
Spots I wasn't even focused on holding more mysteries.
Part of this video, and I'm going to point out two things you need to pay attention to right here, which is the head. And if you look really close, there's and what you will see in about a minute is a hand. That, I believe, is some creature, non-human, crouching down. And that was its eye I just pointed at. And I want you to pay attention to what appear to be fingers running up the fence, as if it's kneeling down or something and peering out. And then there you go. See the fingers? And I think I go back and forth a couple times here, but it looks to me like there's a little other or a big creature looking through the fence on the bottom there, crouched down. I mean, maybe I'm wrong, but you tell me. And then there's his fingers going right up and down, up and down. Just looks like almost a human hand crawling up the fence. And at the very beginning, you see an eye. And I think right here, I show you the fingers. This is my really poor attempt at drawing over the fingers, but you get it. So what's really interesting about this is it is happening next to them and kind of in front of them, but behind a fence.
Why on earth would such an advanced, intelligent creature fly millions of miles across the universe just to come rub its fingers on a fence in front of your camera in your backyard? And in such a stereotypical, creepy fashion. It is stupid. Yet again, such stories are the livelihood of conspiracy theorists, and a lot of them feed off of people's attention and stupidity. So, here's what I think. Just like religious miracles and paranormal apparitions, UFO and alien sightings always happen to elude the eyes of the majority and appear only before the cameras of a few individuals, or a group of actors. This leaves most people with the options of either believing these sources or not. And since most already live with preconceived ideas and rate average to below average in intelligence, they are gullible and take whatever they see as proof that fits their own beliefs. The universe is indeed large, and the probability of another conscious and capable form of life existing on another planet is high. But this only increases the chances of our planet being visited by an alien race. With that being said, this alien race would not just appear to military aircraft or some sketchy individuals, but to everyone on planet Earth. This is not to mention that it's utterly absurd to assume that those aliens are going to look anything like the gray and green humanoids spawned by the imagination of 20th century Western men. I mean, the first mentions of such extraterrestrial creatures come from fictional books written by Western authors, like H.G. Wells during the 19th century and Gustav Sandgren during the early 20th century.
In contrast to the lack of little green men abductions, little grey humanoids is a popular description given by those who claim to have been abducted, accounting for a whopping 43% of all alien abduction reports in the United States, 50% in Australia, and 90% in the United States' hat. As to why grey aliens prefer Canadians, we just think that's probably because they're really nice. Just as interesting is that only 12% of abduction reports in the UK and 20% in the rest of Europe describe some variant of grey-skinned aliens doing the abducting. So, where did the common idea of hairless, large-headed, black-eyed, grey-skinned aliens actually come from in the first place? The first documented instances of a description of such beings, though in this case with them being our evolved selves, comes from H.G. Wells' 1893 Man of the Year Million. In it, he describes humanity having evolved into large-headed, black, oval-eyed, short, grey-skinned beings, similar to what is commonly depicted when most people today think of grey aliens. Wells later repeated similar descriptions in other works, including sometimes representing aliens. Clearly, Wells must have been in the lizard people's inner circle to know about the grey aliens long before anyone would ever be abducted by them. From there, Gustav Sandgren doubled down on this description of aliens in his 1933 book titled The Unknown Danger, where he states, "The creatures did not resemble any race of humans. They were short, shorter than the average Japanese, and their heads were big and bald, with strong square foreheads and very small noses and mouths and weak chins. What was most extraordinary about them were the eyes, large, dark, gleaming with a sharp gaze. They wore clothes made of soft grey fabric, and their limbs seemed to be similar to those of humans."
Neither man claimed that he has seen aliens, or that his works were inspired by actual aliens who looked like bipedal primates with deformed limbs and oversized heads. The Western description and depiction of the stereotypical alien has been based on these two men's imagination ever since, and people still believe that this is somehow exactly what aliens look like. I also came across another video where this guy talks about crop circles, or the peculiar patterns of flattened crops that allegedly appear out of nowhere. He goes on to make connections between crop circles, alien messages, electromagnetism, and wormholes, then tries to explain how the American government has been trying to hide the origins of crop circles by paying off some men to claim they've been behind it all along. Of course, he's just repeating what others have said before, precisely on those old TV programs that appealed to popular superstitions and beliefs to gain public attention back in the day. But what he does here is grab all these clusters of information from different spots and randomly stick them together so he can baffle the audience into seeing patterns where they don't exist. If you take each case and dissect it individually, you'll learn that all of them are unrelated, unsubstantiated, debunked, and rebuked by the science community, whether it's crop circles, alien messages, or flying saucers. This is not to mention that among the things he uses as evidence are these, hinting to the same stereotypical Western depiction of aliens, which instantly calls his entire case into question.
Though crop formations seem like a new phenomenon, there's evidence they've been appearing for a long time. In the 9th century, Abelard, the Bishop of Lyon in France, wrote about parishioners who were possibly engaged in devil worship or paganism. They were collecting seeds out of flattened circles in the fields and using them for fertility rituals. In 1686, Robert Plott, a professor at Oxford, wrote about crop circles. He even drew pictures of a couple that appeared near his home. He said they were formed by a flash of light, and once they were formed, animals wouldn't go near them. Around the same time, a pamphlet was released called The Mowing Devil. It describes how a farmer woke to see a bright light in his field that he thought was fire. When he went to investigate, he found a crop circle. It's called the Mowing Devil because the farmer said the circle was so neatly mowed that it could not have been done by a mortal man. John Leland served as librarian to Henry VIII. He wrote about patterns appearing in grass overnight.
In the case of Agobard of Lyon, well, let's first get something straight. His name was Agobard, not Abigard. If you read his work called On Hail and Thunder, you'll actually find Agobard condemning the people who believe there are sailors from the mythical cloud realm of Magonia, who supposedly paid off some magicians to raise storms so they could steal crops from the weather-stricken fields. I've not found anything about parishioners stealing seats from flattened circles, so it would have been great had this guy referenced the source from where he got that story. In regards to the quadrangle shape that naturalist Robert Plott mentions, it actually resembles a crop mark, which is a change in growth that affects some crops due to the condition of the soil and what's buried beneath it, or differences in water reaching the roots. If there are patterns of old structures or building blocks buried beneath the soil, they can affect crop growth in time and thus create crop marks. Again, if this guy can provide the source that proves Robert Plott was writing about crop circles, it would be great. Jem Schnabel, an author known for writing on controversial topics, explores the history and origins of crop circles, and he himself rejects the assumption that the crop formation mentioned in The Moaning Devil is a crop circle, pointing out that the crops in the story are cut down, not bent. Looking at this guy talk, you'd wonder where he takes all those historical details. And during my research, I found another source from where he's picked ideas for his video. I came across an article authored by Tara McIsaac. She mentions the exact historical items in her article about crop circles. Looking into Tara's background, she works for the newspaper and media company called The Epoch Times, which is where her article was published. Looking into The Epoch Times, it appears it is involved in many controversial materials, which, for the sake of relevance, I will not be addressing here, but this includes promoting conspiracy theories. You can read more about it in the link in the description. But back to Tara's article. In what appears to be an effort to conceal bias or seem neutral, it states details that actually invalidate the paranormal theories on the things mentioned in those historical accounts. For example, it mentions, quote, Plott hypothesized that the formations were created by lightning or other forces during thunderstorms. Gary Bobroff, in his book Crop Circles, Jung, and the Reemergence of the Archetypal Feminine, noted, Today, formations continue to be found the night after tremendous thunderstorms. The 2001 Milk Hill Formation, consisting of 409 individual circles and spanning 1,000 feet across, being perhaps the finest example of this correlation. End quote. About another historic account, it states, quote, In the July 29, 1880 edition of the journal Nature, John Rand Capron published an article titled Storm Effects that described crop circles in detail. Part of his description reads, These all presented much the same character. A few standing stalks as a center, some prostrate stalks with their heads arranged pretty evenly in a direction forming a circle around the center, and outside these a circle or wall of stalks which had not suffered. In the case of John Leyland, Tara claims he commented on the traditional maypole dance, saying, We go out in the early hours and we learn the patterns that appear on the grass overnight. I would have appreciated a reference, because I wasn't able to find where the chronicler makes that statement. But even if he did, nothing about the quote alone suggests anything crop circles. And that's why referencing a work is important, so that the viewer can study the context for themselves and see whether you're presenting the information correctly. As for the viewer, there is no excuse to being uninformed. We live in a time where knowledge is accessible to everyone at the click of a button. Learning has never been easier than it is today. Yet, not everyone makes use of this, and conspiracy theorists know. They know that the people who come across their videos are likely too lazy to actually do research themselves, and don't have the capacity for critical thought. In any case, what I find interesting is the title of this man's video, and what he says at the end.
John Lundberg is an English artist and documentary filmmaker who founded the website CircleMakers.org in the early 90s. He's responsible, or claims to be responsible, for some of the more elaborate crop formations that have been found over the years. On the Circle Makers website, which is still around, there are links to the many crop formations that the group takes credit for. There's no doubt that the Circle Makers created complicated and often very beautiful crop formations. But crop circle researchers Robert Hulse.
And I was quite aware that it was an ET encounter, and I'm quite used to it. So I really wanted to speak to them. So I said, I was in my mind, I was trying to say, speak to me, please. But of course, my vocal cords wouldn't work. I couldn't do anything. Through some great effort, I managed to just move my head maybe a tiny amount so that I could peer over the bedclothes and look. And standing in front of the wardrobe was a being. And then that being was about 4 foot tall. He was in exactly the same shape as a grey, with the you know, bigger head. The eyes were exactly the same as a grey's eyes, and black, absolutely black. But the whole of the body was made out of light, and I lie on my stomach quite often when I'm asleep, you know. So I'd lie on my stomach with my head looking towards the other, the bigger side of the bed, you know, where my wife used to sleep, say, you know. And then I felt somebody tugging the bedclothes on my side. And I thought, hello, I've got a visitor. But I'm okay with it, so it's not a problem. So without getting up, I turned my head and to look. And as I'm moving, I realised I'm moving in slow motion. And then I turned, and there, right there, was this being, a type I've never seen before. And it was like a bronzy sort of a colour. It didn't seem to be fully materialised in this dimension, because his head was like there, and I could see down to about here, say. And so I imagined the rest of him was materialised in the living room, through the floor and in the living room, sort of, you know. But anyway, I stared at this being for 30 seconds anyway, and he was quite different. He had large, very large, round eyes. I could tell that because you could see the bone structure. The eyelids not only came down from the top, but they came up from the bottom. I suppose like a lizard's eyes sort of do, you know. And the eyelids were kind of slanted. The part of the eye that you could see made a slant. So if you didn't look carefully, you could think maybe it had slanty eyes. But because I could see the skull shape, I could see that they were big round eyes. So that was one important thing. The other thing was, on the bridge of the nose were three or four very, very deep wrinkles. You know, we screw our nose up when we get wrinkles here, but these were of a different order altogether. So, you know, really very, very marked. The other thing was that the being was bald, had no hair, and very prominently on the top of the head, running from the back of the head to the front, or vice versa, was a very pronounced ridge, which I don't think it was jagged or anything like that. It was just a ridge that was raised up down the middle of the forehead, of the skull. And after about 30 seconds of examining him as carefully as I could, he spoke to me telepathically in my head, and he said, "The time has come for you to know more of the truth." And I thought, great, because I'm ready.
And David A. Caton thinks there's more to John than meets the eye.
But in our opinion, the whole Circle Makers website and Lomberg and co. are all part of a disinformation campaign, possibly funded by government.
Robert Hull said at one time, the Circle Makers website had a recruiting link that took you directly to the recruitment page for MI5, British Military Intelligence. Hulse believes that the Circle Makers group is funded by British intelligence and was specifically created to spread disinformation. Hulse believes the Circle Makers' goal is to muddy the waters and confuse serious crop circle researchers to make it as difficult as possible to determine what was and wasn't a genuine crop formation. Now, there's no hard evidence that the Circle Makers or its founder are connected to military intelligence. But in 2009, researcher Richard D. Hall dug into Lundberg's background and found a lot of interesting information. Lundberg got his master's from the Slade School of Fine Art in London in 1992. At this time, Slade was next door to the then-secret headquarters of MI5 at 140 Gower Street. It was literally next door. The two buildings shared a courtyard. Hall makes the point that intelligence agencies often recruit final-year college students. That's always been true and is still true today. Lundberg started making crop circles immediately after graduating. Hall notes that if you view the HTML source of CircleMakers.org, the second keyword is MI5. Now, that was in 2009, but even today, the site's keywords contain entries like MI5 and CIA. And something I just noticed while researching this episode, why is alleged CIA asset Jim Schnabel a keyword on this site? In 2004, the Circle Makers website teased Colin Andrews, who at the time was raising money for his research. Circle Makers said that if the fundraising fails, Colin could just join MI5 PSYOPs and retrain to be a crop circles maker. Now, PSYOPs is short for psychological operations, which is the use of psychological techniques and tactics to influence the perceptions, attitudes, and behaviors of a group of people. And this is a type of strategic communication used by military intelligence and government organizations all the time.
It sure is. Just turn on the news.
Well, that's true. If you spend an hour reading the news today, you consumed government intel. Believe me. Now, Hall acknowledges that these references to MI5 seem just too blatant, but he believes they're a double bluff. Meaning, if we sarcastically connect ourselves to the intelligence community, people will think we're joking. Nobody would be so obvious. But this is absolutely a real and effective PSYOPs technique. Hall found that the website was hosted in Pittsburgh. Now, at the time, and even today, to some degree, it's uncommon for British organizations to host their sites in the U.S. And Hall found that the administrative contact for the domain belongs to a colonel in the U.S. Air Force. Now, it could be a coincidence, but the man has an unusual name. Now, I'm not going to name him here, but I'll link to Hall's research down below. Richard Hall. Richard Hall looked into Circle Makers' finances, trying to figure out how to pay their bills. Lundberg had registered a couple of companies, but they were inactive. But there was an interesting quote on the Circle Makers website.
You'd be surprised how expensive running a successful website can be. Don't panic. We're not going to ask you for money. Our retainer, from sources we'd rather not disclose, has kept our virtual head above water.
What does that mean? A retainer? From who? Who's financing them? Making crop formations is technically a crime. It's trespassing, vandalism, destruction of private property. What investor would fund that and become complicit in those crimes? Plus, there could be civil liability. If you create a crop circle and a bunch of strangers show up and tear up my field, I could sue you for that. Even if they're minor crimes and rarely prosecuted, it doesn't sound like a good investment. Hall did a land registry check on the apartment where Lundberg was living at the time. He found that, technically, there are no apartments listed on the deed. Hall dug further and found that there are 4 apartments, including Lundberg's, that have their rents paid by the local government. So, did Richard Hall reveal that John Lundberg is, in fact, an asset working in media whose job is to spread disinformation about crop circles? Well, the evidence Hall provides is purely circumstantial and coincidental, so there's no way to know for sure. In fact, some of Hall's evidence is so far-fetched, I left it out of this episode. But a few years after Richard Hall conducted his research, Lundberg directed a documentary. A documentary that I've referred to multiple times on this channel. It's called Mirage Men. Mirage Men covers Richard Doty, a retired special agent who worked for OSI, the United States Air Force Office of Special Investigation, Air Force Intelligence. Richard Doty is, according to Mirage Men, one of the chief architects of the military's campaign to disseminate lies to the UFO community. In other words, to spread disinformation. Doty's job was to muddy the waters, so UFO researchers wouldn't know what sightings were real and what were hoaxes. Now this is, according to Hall, Hulse, Caton, and many others, exactly what the Circle Makers have done and have been doing to the crop circles community for years. There's a reason why John Lundberg would make a great intelligence asset, and Rosemary Guiley, and James Schnabel, and countless other writers, journalists, and media figures. They already work in the paranormal community. They're trusted by that community. They continue to do their work, but every so often they spread a little bit of disinformation to that community. A little nugget to steer people away from the truth. This is why you shouldn't trust anyone in the media. Whether it's your favorite news anchor, TV show host, podcaster, blogger, or writer, be wary of anyone with influence. These media personalities may seem trustworthy. They may seem like they have your best interests in mind, but some of that is just a performance. Not all of it, but some of it is a performance designed to sway your opinion or even alter your entire belief system. The intelligence community does not want you to know the truth about crop circles, UFOs, secret space programs, or alien technology. That's a fact. Millions, perhaps billions of dollars are put into black budget programs designed to distract and confuse you from the truth. When CIA needs to spread disinformation, they look for trustworthy people with large audiences to deliver their message. So keep your eye out for clues. An intelligence operative, an agent, an asset could be anyone.
If we sarcastically connect ourselves to the intelligence community, people will think we're joking. Nobody would be so obvious. But this is absolutely a real and effective PSYOPs technique.
This guy does not strike me as somewhat stupid. I find it quite interesting how bold he is when attributing hidden motives to his country's intelligence agency and asserting that they're actively deceiving their citizens. While he has such a large audience, has no direct evidence to back his claim, and is clearly not even putting any effort into remaining anonymous. In the case of thecirclemakers.org, if you go to the website's HTML source, you'll see words like, quote, weird shit, hoaxing, fake, paranormal, weird, seriology, John Lundberg, Rod Dickinson, Robert Irving, Jim Schnabel, and Julian Richardson, end quote. I don't think this man is oblivious to the fact that HTMLs and website source codes can be customized and edited by their hosts. Whoever made the website has obviously added all the weird shit that revolved around the topic at the time. He did make a good point, though. With the sighting of a UFO, a family disappearing after claiming to have seen aliens in May, a US intelligence officer suddenly turning an informant, and the explosion of blatant media coverage supporting the suggestion of extraterrestrial visitors, is almost like there is a current PSYOP, but one that intends to convince people that there are in fact aliens visiting our planet. And if that's the case, this video would certainly be part of it. Keep in mind that if the government didn't want you to know about something, you will not know about it. And even if there was a leak that you happened to catch wind of, they would naturally use their resources to minimize or limit its spread, not play on it like this. This could also explain the disappearance of the family that claimed seeing aliens, as it would be sensible for the government to relocate them away from the flow of curious crowds wanting to learn what happened. The longer they're out being confronted by questions, the higher the chances of a leak.
Today is June 12th. I'm outside my house with my family. You can see people are saying that we disappeared, the news stations. You know, what I learned these couple days, that everything on TV is fake. And especially the news channels, they'll say fake stuff, and it's not true. You know, I already said what I had to say. If you want to believe it, believe it. I don't care no more. I just want to, you guys understand, because of you guys, I have depression. I have anxiety attacks. And I just want to be normal again. I don't feel okay, guys. And just move on, guys. Forget about it and just...
But if there was a secret campaign to convince people that there are extraterrestrials visiting the Earth, why is everyone saying that the government is trying to hide the fact? Well, that's how reverse psychology works. In such a case, the job of media outlets would be to publicize and spread the idea, while content creators with special interests and large audiences would take the people's side and ask the people's questions, as a way of maintaining influence and staying updated on people's attitudes and opinions. In such a scenario, the government would act like it's been caught hiding the evidence, and that is just slowly submitting to the people's request to reveal the evidence of alien visits to our planet. I mean, why are aliens so obsessed with crashing all over North America and nowhere else? And why keep the evidence hidden in the first place, only to reveal it later? If letting people know there are aliens would create some kind of threat to national security, then the evidence won't be revealed no matter what. And if letting people know would not create such kind of a threat, then there would be no reason to keep the evidence a secret in the first place. As for the purpose behind an operation like that, well, that'll be left to your imagination. It could be experimental, or it could be preparatory in nature. But again, this is just a theory. Deception used by governments is not a new or strange thing itself, but that's what makes it better to play on rather than completely deny. And if this guy is an asset, he sure is daring his audience to figure that out. Reports of aliens, UFOs, angels, and goblins have been circulating all throughout human existence for a long time now. Just like the Big Bang Theory remains modern civilization's creation myth, aliens and UFOs are merely the imagination of modern lore. Everything seen flying in the sky throughout history has been explained to have natural causes, and everything unexplained has only appeared to questionable sources. It is in human nature to reject uncertainty and fantasize about things beyond the known, because it makes life more interesting. The idea that something beyond the normal exists gives people's minds something to chew on. It's very difficult for people to accept that reality is a lot more blunt, simple, and depressing than they'd like it to be. And their inability to think critically doesn't help them at all. It just makes them a perfect target audience for trickery and experimentation. So, to conclude this video, facts are pieces of information that can be examined, tested, and experimented with by the majority. And if such things like aliens and UFOs are being hidden from public examination or scientific experimentation, then chances are they're fake, just like all other creatures spawned by the human imagination.